Well, welcome, welcome,
Welcome,
welcome,
welcome, welcome.
everybody. Welcome, welcome. All right, we tried something new. We tried something fantastic, and I hope that everybody is coming on. And welcome to Instagram, all those who are coming in, as well as to Facebook Live. Let's put that in right over there if we can.
Got it.
You got it? All right. So tonight we are excited because we're continuing. Let's turn this on. We are continuing in. God bless you, Sister Carrie. How are you? Did you have an exciting day? I pray that you did a full day, a blessed day. So I got excited tonight.
Hey,
I
everybody.
got it. I got real excited tonight. God bless you. To Wendell that's coming in tonight for our evening Bible study. We tried something new, and that was good evening, Sister Gwen. How are you? We are doing well. I tell you, I don't know about the weather. The weather seemed like it was trying to do something crazy with me, but I'm hanging in there and still making it a good day. God bless you, Mother Diane. For all of those that are coming in tonight, God bless you, Sister Jan, Minister Janice. How are you? We are doing well. We're hanging in there. God
bless you,
bless
everybody.
You.
God
God
bless
bless you,
everybody.
Minister
God bless
Pope.
you.
Yeah. God bless you, Mother Lana. Amen. Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing? How was your day? Type it in and let us know. I tell you, it was a good day today, but you can hear a little froggy in my throat, so I don't know. It could just be the pollen or whatever. But welcome. God bless you, Deacon. Deacon Everett that's coming in. God bless you to all those who are coming in on this side with Instagram. We welcome you, welcome you, welcome you to another evening of exciting learning. Hallelujah.
Amen.
For
all Amen.
Those who are students of the Word of God. Yes. Let's see here. All right. Wanted to make sure there wasn't anybody else coming up that I did not address. Good evening to you as well. And good evening to Reverend Fote. You guys are doing good. I know you are. Yes. Your day was most exciting, Mother Lorna. God bless you. And so was ours. I'm fighting. I tell you, I think it's just really a lot of this pollen that's going on that's sort of bothering me and affecting me a little bit. But we were supposed to get some hot tea, and I didn't bring the hot tea out here. The day was especially blessed. Yes, Sister Gwen. We got to walk into the blessings of the Lord, I tell you, because it does make us rich and it takes away all of the sorrow. So we praise God. So we're just going to go ahead on with this little scratchy voice that's going on here tonight. God bless you, Sister Cora, that's coming in tonight, and everybody that's coming in tonight. I know these names are just rolling, rolling, rolling. But as I said, we're excited. God bless you, our brother. Dwayne is coming in. Sister Marcy, God bless you. For coming in with us, studying in the Word. Well, tonight, for all of those that are coming in, make sure you hit that share button and share it with someone else so that they can also get into the Word of God and become empowered and become impacted so that we could go out and do the will of the God. And that's why we're continuing in our series tonight, the I Am series. But before we go into the Word, you want to talk a little bit about that song?
Oh, we'll give thanks unto the Lord. We we started this song, I believe I was in the church, and I started playing around with a few chords, and it was just taste and see that the Lord is good. And I just had that little melody, and I just added some verses and some modulations, and a little hook at the end. And I'll never forget, Brother Randy Gibson said to me, "No, that's a good song. That's a good song." You know, and the way that we arranged it, the vocals, and we had Brother Aaron Williams and Sister Leona Bostic,
yeah.
And who else? Sister Tammy was there.
Here?
Yeah, along with our singers. Sister
I
Tammy.
Think Sister Vernay.
Sister Vernay.
Sister
Fernando.
Victoria.
Yeah, Sister Victoria, Fernanda, and Carl.
There. Carl.
Carl, along with our... Yeah,
sing.
And
yeah.
So we put that song together, and it was one of those songs that caught on. You know, it's one of those repeat and echo kind of thing, you know? And it caught on. And when it caught on, people in the studio started singing it. And when people in the studio started singing it, we knew that we had a pretty good song that people would like. I ain't gonna say a hit, but we knew that we had a song that people would like. And we like to sing songs that people enjoy. You know, so, yeah. So that's old Taste and See.
That the Lord is good.
That the Lord is good. Good.
I tell you, some people were talking the other day about how good it is to have precious memories. I'm telling you, when you have precious memories that outweigh the bad memories, you can go on.
Yeah.
And life is worth living. Yeah. So we should make sure that we do that every day. Now, don't turn that music off, or some kind of music, because you know we love to have some music or praise music behind us, just a little, but just enough where, you know, they can hear us teaching tonight. That might be a little bit.
Well, let's go ahead and go off.
Oh, it's going to go off.
Yeah.
What are you going to put on?
I have no idea.
Put some praise music on once that goes off. But anyway, the good memories outweigh the bad memories any day. And
absolutely.
If we could just focus on the good memories, you can make it through.
That's right.
Right? No matter what's happening, no matter what's going on, no matter what report we get, whether it's with our bodies, whether it's with family members, whether it's with friends, whether it's in society, you can go on if you could just continue to focus
on
those good memories. God bless you too, Mother, and good evening to you as well. Hallelujah. The day has been indescribable. Listen, I know he did something favorable. He did an unmeasurable meaning for you today. I can tell that. When people start talking like that, I tell you, God has done something wonderful, and we want to make sure we express it. I want to find out later, because I already know it's something good. I know it's something juicy that the Lord did. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, while we're still enjoying the rest of that song, you guys can get ready and go with us. As I said, we're continuing in our study of the true vine, where Jesus made that powerful statement in the book of John, the 15th chapter and verse 1, where he says, "I am the true vine." And so tonight we're going to focus. Our focus scripture tonight is going to be on verse 8. Remember, we said that we were going to exegete that chapter, because that's a powerful, powerful chapter. And I'm going to read that from verses 1 through 8 tonight to refresh us in the Word of God. So I hope you have your Word, and let's go along in the Word of God. All right? Here's what it says. Oh, wait a minute. I have to get y'all's glasses, because if I don't get your glasses, then y'all can't see. I'm going to be all right, but y'all can't see. It says that I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. And every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, and that it may bring forth more fruit. They have an instrumental worship and gossip. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. Ye are the branches, and he that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. And if a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burnt. Verse 7 says this: If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what you will. Now, that's some powerful stuff right there. And it shall be done unto you. Here's where we are with verse 8. Herein is my Father glorified. Right? You got to listen to that. I want you to underline that. Herein is my Father glorified. And then Jesus goes on to say why. That you bear much fruit. Then he says, so shall ye be my disciples. So this last verse in verse 8, it really prompts us as believers to be able to answer two questions. And that's what we're going to look at tonight. We're going to pull this apart. It makes us, if Jesus is saying that his Father is glorified when we bear much fruit, and it shows that we are his disciples, it's going to make us answer the question, who I am? Mm-hmm. That's number one. and why am I here? So these questions have to be right in life. If we're going to understand our meaning, if we're going to understand our purpose for being, we're going to have to understand those two questions. We're going to have to answer those two questions. It's almost like a man, and I'm saying this to you because you operate with tools. Somebody got, is it a monkey wrench or just a wrench?
A monkey wrench.
Monkey wrench. And he confuses it with his screwdriver. And he's like, well, this is the screwdriver. And you're going, no, this is a monkey wrench.
Right.
You know, it's the same thing. Likewise with us, we have to be experienced and we have to understand what the word of God is saying so that we don't become confused and move in failure and have any failure in our life trying to interpret or do something different other than what God wants us to do. He said that we should be fruitful. Mm-hmm. And in this makes his Father, makes the Father glorified. So let's take a look at that. So the Christian needs to not have this identity crisis. That's my whole point for using that analogy, so that we don't have an identity crisis, because many times a lot of believers do. We're walking around, we're saying, well, who am I? Well, what am I here for? Well, Jesus tells us what we're here for. We're here to bear much fruit and to glorify his Father. That's what the scripture tells us. We are the branches and Christ is the vine. So here we are the fruit. And Jesus himself tells us in John the 15th chapter and verse 5 that I am the vine, you are the branch. And if a man remains in me, he says, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. So like any branch that draws nourishment, we must now bear fruit. Mm-hmm. Once you accept this simple fact, you are on the way of making your life meaningful and useful. So let's dig right into that. Number one, disciples of Christ bear fruit. Disciples of Christ bear fruit. And the reason God saved us, let's look at this. The whole reason that God saved us is so that we can bear fruit, not just in one place, but we bear fruit around the world. So let's look at these scriptures before we go into how we become fruit bearers. When you look at verse 2, it says it's like a gardener, that God looks for branches to bear fruit. That's us. Verse number 5, God expects branches attached to the vine to bear fruit. And then verse 8, fruit bearing is a sign of discipleship. And of course, I have verse 8:16. We probably won't even go there tonight. 16 says that God has chose us and appointed us to go and to bear fruit. So those who have been saved, those who have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, are expected to lead and to live a converted life, a life of gratitude, a life filled with good works. We're going to talk about that as we go on, and a life of overflowing, an overflowing life of fruit.
Yeah, well, yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. And then I just had the next question we're going to answer. Why does our Father want fruit in the lives of those who are saved and redeemed? Why does he want us to have fruit? Jesus answers this question. And Jesus says, this is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit. Now, when Jesus says this is to my Father's glory that bear much fruit, I have to use myself, Pastor Dykeman, as a gardener. And you know, Pastor Dykeman don't have a green thumb, so he would always just go out and water everything. He'd help me that way. And we call ourselves doing it together. But as a gardener, I mean, I took pride in my work. You named it and I grew it. I grew different types of greens. Pastor Dykeman introduced me to okra. I grew peppers. I grew tomatoes. And the one thing I tried that came out really good that I was really proud of, I grew the vine of the watermelon and I grew the vine of the strawberries. And every time I went out, my neighbors would always compliment as everything was growing. Oh, your garden looks so good. Everything looks so beautiful. Man, I felt so good. I'm like, I'm a good gardener. Hallelujah. And so when I looked at my vegetables, when I looked at my garden, that made me look good. That reflected on me. And so when we do good works, when we bear fruit in our lives for the things that God has given us, no matter what it is that he's called us to do, he has enabled and he has equipped us to be able to do good works. The unbeliever can't do good works.
Right.
And as we go down, we're going to look at why. when we look at Galatians, the fifth chapter, the good works that God has called us to do, and the unfruitful, evil, bad works that unbelievers do. They can't do good works. We do good works. But when we do good works, what Jesus is saying is that reflection goes to the Father. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's just proud of the fact that that's my son. That's my daughter. I anointed them. I've given them gifts and talents and skills and abilities. He's enabled us to have good jobs and to do businesses and to have intellect. A mind is a terrible thing to waste. Mm-hmm. He's given us wisdom. He's given us wherewithal. He's given us the Holy Spirit that will lead us into truth so we can do good works. And when we do good in the earth and help the poor and help those who have need, that reflects on the Father.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, it reflects on the Father in such a way where if we are saved, it should lead us to do good works. You know, Paul says, I can give my body to be burned. He goes over that list of things that he could do. He could bestow his goods to feed the poor. Mm-hmm. He does all those things. And he says, but if I lack that agape love, if I lack that love of God, he said, I am nothing. It's nothing. And so even as an unbeliever, you have what we call people like in Romans 2, they call themselves moralizers. You know, and we go to Bible school, we call them the moralizers, chapter 2 of Romans. And it's people who say, hey, listen, I'm going to do good works and I'm going to make sure that this hospital is named after me. I'm going to take care of this burn center. They do all these wonderful,
all
good works,
wonderful good works,
but it means nothing. It means nothing because it's really not coming into a place of eternal salvation for them. Mm-hmm. You know, you cannot get into heaven by doing just worldly good works. However, if you are saved, now that's different. If you are saved and you're not doing good works, then you gotta kind of want to check where your heart really is with God. Because I want to read this passage of scripture real quick because it comes to mind now that we're talking about this. Ephesians, the second chapter, in that 10th verse. I mean, it's a really powerful scripture where he says
Ephesians,
the second chapter and the 10th verse.
Mm-hmm. I'm laughing at Stoney's remark as we get it. She says, I can't even grow a plastic plant, Pastor. Yeah. I'm still trying.
Ephesians 2 verse 10 says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Mm-hmm. In other words, even before you and I were saved, it was in God's plan that when we got saved, that we would do good works. It was already foreordained. So if we say we are saved, we say that we're abiding in the vine, and we say that we're, you know, we're supposed to be producing fruit, and there is no fruit out of our lives, then we have to go back and look and say, hey, Lord, how come I'm not getting good works? How come I'm not doing good works? And then you have, you know, I think we went over, you know, how people sometimes identify what is good fruit and what is not good fruit. We don't want to go back over and relitigate all of that tonight. But, you know, because sometimes people think good fruit is something simple and really means nothing, when really good fruit may be giving somebody a drink of water and showing them love. And you may never see that person again, but that person will never forget your act of love. Mm-hmm. That act of love may have changed their life forever. So sometimes we don't even see the good works that will be accomplished. I think it was the Winans who had a song that said, for we may never know all the people we have reached. We
may never know
all the, we will never
know.
But we do know a record you do keep. And in the end, you know, when the end finally does begin, we will receive, we'll receive a great reward for what we've done.
Absolutely.
There are things that you and I have done to bless other people's lives.
I was thinking,
we don't even know it.
I was thinking particular of when you said that things you and I have done, we may never know. A lot of times we went into the hospitals.
Right.
And when we went to visit our own, meaning our members or a friend or somebody said a friend of a family member of their family.
Right.
But we never left out without praying for that person on the other side.
Right.
That was a good work.
Right. That was
that
a good
was
work.
Fruit.
All those are good works. All of those are good works. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you and I, when I say you and I, I'm talking about them too, though.
Right, right.
You know, when I say you and I, we may have done some stuff that we don't even think about. That if somebody mentioned to you, you remember when you did such and such so and so? It may have, you'd be like, you don't even remember when you did it. But it changed their life.
Mm-hmm.
It did something great for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so God is saying we should be producing fruit.
Yes.
And we should be having such an attitude with us about producing fruit that we should be looking forward to it. It's something that we look forward to.
Absolutely.
I just believe is what Jesus says, abiding in the vine.
Absolutely.
That abiding in the vine guarantees fruit.
Absolutely.
I absolutely believe what Jesus is saying.
I believe that too with you. I absolutely believe that. Can we establish your point tonight? Is it impossible as a believer not to bear good fruit? Because that needs to be solid with some people, because as you and I are talking right now,
believers can bear bad fruit.
Yeah.
Is that what you're asking?
But in the reverse, let me put it this way. Because we are believers,
right,
because we are Christians,
right,
it's impossible for us not to bear good fruit. In other words, we are capable of bearing good fruit, and I say that because a lot of times there are some believers who believe that they cannot. They're not sure what they're supposed to do. They're going to work, but they're not sure if they're bearing good fruit. They're being a good mother, a good father, a good sister, a good sibling, a good friend, but they don't believe that they're bearing good fruit. And as believers, God has equipped us. He has designed us. He has created us.
Yes.
He has molded and made us. As believers, that when we accept him, we will bear good fruit.
Yeah.
So it's impossible for us not to bear good fruit.
Yeah, well, I think it comes
to Gwen put, it comes from the heart. Yes, from the heart and many, many other things.
Yeah, but I think it comes back to who are you relying on for the fruit to bear, right? Because you have to be relying on the Holy Spirit, right? Because except you abide in the vine, and what goes to the vine?
Yep.
The Spirit of God.
Yeah, yeah.
Those nutrients that gives the branches.
Which makes it possible for us.
Exactly right.
If we're abiding in him.
Right. Those nutrients that are going through the vine and into the branches, just consider that the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
He's going into that branch, and what is he doing? He's conditioning that mind, conditioning that heart, convicting and convincing, teaching, instructing. He's doing everything we need.
It's the enablement of the Holy Spirit
that makes the difference. It's not whether or not I want to do them, or whether or not I have good enough efforts, or whether I don't have good enough efforts. I'm telling you,
it's
impossible to abide in the vine.
That's what I'm talking about right there. It's impossible. That's what I'm saying. Yes.
It's impossible.
It's impossible.
Because it's not up to you.
Right.
It's impossible.
It's left up to you.
Because it's God working through you.
Yes.
Now, the fact that you abide in the vine means you have surrendered. The fact that you abide in the vine means you're paying attention. The fact that you're not a dried up branch, not producing fruit, means that you're receiving from him.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're receiving from him, that means the Holy Spirit is doing the work.
Right.
And if the Holy Spirit is doing the work, it is impossible. Now, you know, you may not be producing all the fruit you want to see and all the stuff you want to do. You may be in a pruning place right now. God may be pruning you so that you may produce more fruit. But the key is you're producing fruit.
Yes, you still can produce fruit.
Only branches that do not produce fruit are cut off. If you're being pruned, it's because you're producing fruit. You only get pruned if you're producing fruit, and pruning may come with some chastisement, some correction, all those kinds of things, so that you can do what? Bring forth more fruit and much fruit.
Mm-hmm.
So it is impossible. When you look at it from God's perspective.
I wanted us to establish that,
not your perspective,
right,
but from God's perspective.
It's the Holy Spirit giving us.
It's the Holy Spirit that does the work.
He's nurturing us.
It's impossible.
Yeah, it's impossible. That's what I wanted to be established tonight.
Yeah.
So that people can really.
You got to abide in the vine.
I mean, believers in Christ really need to get this so that we can move forward. Because we as pastors, I'm in counseling a lot with people and conversations a lot with people. And I mean intelligent people, you know, not to minimize anybody, but I mean these people have good sense, you know, and their hearts are so right because they say over and over and over again, who am I?
Mm-hmm.
What did God call me for? And I mean, they got Bible. What I'm talking about, they're intelligent. They got Bible. They're teachers of the Bibles, but they're stuck at that same question.
Mm-hmm.
Who am I and what am I here for? Well, we're answering that question tonight.
Mm-hmm.
We're connected to the vine and God has called us to produce much fruit. And we're going to talk about this fruit. I'm going to hop.
And listen, let me just make a natural analogy.
Yeah.
If you are a cherry tree, And you're asking, how come I'm not producing cherries?
Right, that's what people ask me all the time.
And it's December.
Yeah.
You ain't supposed to be producing no cherries in December. You know, you go through different seasons and different changes in your life. And in certain seasons, you don't produce certain kinds of fruit.
True.
The fruit that you're producing in that time, and listen to me when I good, really good, when you're in a winter season of your life, the fruit you're producing is life. You're producing survival to thrive for the spring. Mm-hmm. So all of your sap has gone down to your roots to keep the deeper part of you alive during the winter.
Yes.
And so the deeper part of you will keep everything else alive until the spring comes. And when the springs come, your buds are going to come out.
Stony.
And all of a sudden, you're going to see cherries coming up on your tree. But don't be asking, how come I'm not producing no fruit in the wintertime?
That's right.
Your life will go through seasons for particular kinds of fruit.
And to be true with you, even in the wintertime.
Now, if you're a poinsettia, you may want to ask that question.
I often say it's still good, even though we may not see the fruit we want in a winter season, because many of us have different types of winter season. We can go on there for a long time. What does our winter seasons look like?
Right.
But we're still producing fruit because we're still connected to the vine. We're still, the Holy Spirit is still nourishing us and equipping us and establishing us and renewing our mind and saying, listen, this season is over for you, but I need you to do that. So all that's going on even in your winter season.
Can I talk about what kind of change of season? Just one?
Yeah.
Remember the widow woman who said, you know, the creditors are going to come and take my sons.
Right.
And Elisha said, what do you have? She said, I ain't got but a cruiser.
That's what she said.
You know,
it
said,
was
well,
a
go
dry
ahead.
Season.
It was
for
a dry
her.
Season.
That was
right?
That's what I'm talking about. That's a dry season.
It's a dry season.
Yeah, very low.
She followed what? The word of the man of God.
Yeah.
She followed that word. She told her sons, get all these vessels. He said, borrow not a few. In other words,
get a whole
borrow
lot.
As many as you can.
You can.
You know?
Be an overflow.
And keep pouring.
Yeah.
Now, the oil keeps pouring
right.
until they run out of vessels.
Yeah.
When they run out of vessels,
that's when it stops.
The oil stops.
That's when it ceases.
So that season for pouring, remember they had a dry season. Then he had a season for pouring.
Yes.
Then the man of God said, she said, now what? The man of God said, now go sell it and take care of your debt and, you know, take care of your household. Now she's in a season of productivity where now everything that's going to happen in her life, the fruit of it's coming and she's going to be able to pick the fruit now of productivity. You can go through different seasons. When she finished selling all that oil, she'll be in a different season.
I'm telling you.
Now she won't be in a season of poverty. You know what I mean? She won't be in a season of lack, but she will be in a different season.
She'll be in a different
season. Her oil business will be over. And so she got to know what to do in that season.
If she chooses to, with all of that oil she had, she can become like the virtuous woman.
Right.
She can become a businesswoman, an entrepreneur woman. She can become an
investor. Diversify
investments. Very, very diversified.
Absolutely.
She can offer people jobs. I mean,
there's
so many things that we could look at and say by her being blessed with the abundance of that oil that the prophet made sure that she had by feeding him first, by just being obedient to the word of God.
Yeah.
So you can't outdo.
You got to do the work.
That's why we tell people it's better to give than it is to receive. Mm-hmm. You don't know what God, she didn't know that kind of favor was going to come upon her.
Right.
But God made her wealthy. Here's what I love about that scripture, Pastor Dykeman. It never ran out.
It never ran out.
See what God do?
Never ran.
For us to be fruitful, let's go back to that. We can never not be fruitful.
It didn't run out until she ran out of vessels.
Right.
Yeah. But now the thing is this. The backstory to that story is that it is believed that her husband, because he is mentioned that he was one of the sons of the prophets, was a prophet of that time.
Yeah.
And he died earlier than what he expected. He died an early death. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't able to build the inheritance that he wanted for his family. Mm-hmm. And so that's why she comes and says, you know how he served you and he loved the Lord and all those kinds of things. And he just didn't expect to die when he died. You know, these kind of things happen.
She got the
inheritance. And that's when Elisha said, yeah, I know, but God's got you. This is what you got to do.
Mm-hmm.
And she just goes and does what she's got to do. And you know, and the thing was, she followed the word of God. I'm going to come back to that. She followed the word of God.
If we know God's intentions for us as believers, just son and daughters, we would be obedient to the word of God and do what he says and give.
Yeah.
And not regret it. And then he says, I love the cheerful, the hilarious giver.
Yeah.
You know, I want you to give and with faith and confidence to know that I'm going to give you back, because now we're going to move from much fruit to more fruit. We're going to talk about that probably next week. So we never run out. I love that illustration about the basket. You never run out of good fruit because, first of all, when we really want to look at this thing, God has put in and established in each and every one of us what we're going to produce anyway.
Right.
So
right.
what I produce, you can't produce what I can produce.
Right.
And I can't produce what you can produce.
Right.
He's already put the fruit in you, or he's already established or designed, I'm looking for another word I want to use, orchestrated, I guess. That's not really what I want to say. Mm-hmm. But he's given you what you need so that you can produce the fruit that God needs to have established on this earth that's going to make him glorified.
At the end, he's got to be glorified.
Oh my God,
he's got to be glorified.
It's going to glorify him.
He's got to be glorified.
He has diversified fruit, different kinds of fruits. We don't. So now I'm going to jump over some stuff, and then we're going to go ahead and talk about this fruit, this type of fruit that we're supposed to bear as believers, besides the natural things that we can bear as being workers and truck drivers and working on farms and nurses and doctors and all these type of things. Let's look at this, the fruit we bear. What is the fruit that God wants us to bear? It takes many different forms, and we can mention only just a few of them, right? Winning others to Christ is a fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we don't even look at that, but that's fruit bearing. Paul wrote to the church of Rome in Romans, the first chapter in verse 13. Let me say that again for you who are writing. Romans, the first chapter, verse 13, it says this, I plant many times to come to you in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I have had among other Gentiles. And in his collections of his wisdoms, he began to say how Solomon could say in Proverbs 11 chapter and 30, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he who wins souls is wise. So ministry is bearing fruit.
Mm-hmm.
When we win souls, we're becoming wise. Ministry is bearing fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Another scripture here is in Mark, the first chapter and verses 17, because we're talking about winning souls.
Mm-hmm.
Mark, the first chapter, verse 17 says, come to me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. So my, this wasn't the King James version that I used. So if you are guys are looking at your Bible and says, her verse is a little bit different. I didn't use the King James version. So, but we're fruit bearing is winning souls.
Mm-hmm.
One other scripture in 2 Corinthians, the fifth chapter, verse 20, Paul begins to compare the evangelist to an ambassador. So no matter where we go, we're representing Christ as an evangelist to do what? To win souls. Another area is another kind of spiritual fruit is holiness or a sanctified life. Glory to God. Holiness and sanctification is also two-pronged endeavor. On the one hand, it involves putting off of sin and evil. And on the other hand, it involves the putting on of what is good and pleasing and perfect in the sight of God. We are to put off such things as, this is what we put off, sexual immorality, impurity, depravities, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousies, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, none of these any kind of good fruit, distinctions, fractions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and likewise. And we are to put on such things as love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's out of Galatians, the fifth chapter, verses 19 through 21. And if you want another scripture, it's Colossians, the third chapter, verses 5 through 14. But if we notice here that love is mentioned first, in these fruits, God is love. And I have here that there's about, did a little research and saw that it was 232 times throughout the New Testament that the word love is used. Put on good works. When we put on love, when we put on joy and patience and all of the fruits of the Spirit, that glorifies our Father. Mm-hmm. So we're to put off sin and we're to put on the love and the joy and the peace. These are the robes of holiness. Mm-hmm. And this is the robe of righteousness. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, you have to look at those fruit-bearing things, such as winning the loss and holiness. Remember, holiness begins with the position of holiness that you automatically get.
Yeah.
When you get saved, you're automatically holy, but then God expects you to walk in it. And mm-hmm. walking it means that I have to put off some things and put on some things, mm-hmm. you know, and you got to be conscious of it.
You have to be conscious of it.
There's no such thing as getting saved and then everything goes away like osmosis. It doesn't. Some things God takes an appetite away from you and you don't even do it no more. Some things you got to discipline yourself. Why? Because you've had experiences with it. Mm-hmm. Your flesh has had experiences with it. You've tasted it. You know what it is. You used to like it. You might still like it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because sin has pleasure.
And most
pleasure.
Times you do, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
it has pleasure to
you. You have to be conscious. You got to know what your triggers are. Whatever your triggers are that'll make you put on something. You know, one of your triggers may have been lying in the past. Well, remember, you may have been lying in the past, and one of the reasons why you lie is because you always wanted to be important in somebody else's eyes. Mm-hmm. So you always had something to say about, if somebody said, man, I went on a great trip and had a good time, then you come back, oh yeah, you should hear about my trip though. And you ain't been nowhere. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But you want them to think that you're just as important as they are. And what some people just lie to lie. They just lie to lie or embellish or whatever. You got to find out, why am I so interested in how people see me or view me? And why do I think if I do something small that it's still insignificant? Mm-hmm. That's why he says, despise not the days of small beginnings, because it's not insignificant. If you look at the mustard seed, you wouldn't think it's going to turn into the tree that it does. There are things that you have to start considering. Why in my perspective is that such a little tiny thing, when yet in that thing God could be glorified in it? Mm-hmm. And if God is being glorified in it, who cares about the opinions of others? And so you have to really start looking at, what are my triggers that make me go back to doing those things? Because I don't want to put lying back on.
Right.
I want to put on truth.
Yeah.
You know, because truth is in holiness and in sanctification. So it's got to be a conscious effort. That's my point. Mm-hmm. You got to be conscious about your sanctification, because the enemy will throw darts at you. The enemy will tempt you. You know, the devil don't know what you got victory over a lot of times. Mm-hmm. He just throw a bunch of stuff out there on the wall to see what stick. Whatever you grab is what he go with. You don't even know. He don't even know everything that you're still holding on to. There's things that you let go in your spirit that you don't even realize you let go until you get confronted with.
That's
it.
True.
And then you're like, you know what? Yeah. There was a time I would have, but you know, I don't even feel tempted to do that anymore. But the enemy put that there so you can see it. And God allowed it so you can see how far you've grown.
Right, right.
That you've gotten victory over in that particular area. So there's a lot of, you know, little nuances to that thing. But in the end, just bear this in mind. Don't ever, ever forget it. You must be conscious about your sanctification.
That's right.
Because you have an ear gate, you got an eye gate, there's stuff that just come into you. If you touch something with your hands, is registering in your brain, whether or not it's hard, whether it's soft, whether it's mushy, whether it's cold, whether it's hot, all that's registering up here in this brain. And you don't want to be touching things that you shouldn't be touching.
Yes.
That will bring triggers back to your brain. You mm-hmm. know, I'm just using that as an example.
Right, right.
But it's just true. It's right, just right. Absolutely true.
Absolutely.
That you and I have this treasure in earthen vessels. Right?
Right.
And we have to maintain a consciousness about this treasure.
Yeah.
We have to maintain a consciousness about it. We just don't want our treasure to be robbed. Mm-hmm. We don't want the enemy in our business anymore. Mm-hmm. So it's a conscious effort to take off the old.
Conscious.
and put on the new.
Absolutely.
Put on the new man created in Christ Jesus.
That's right.
Put on the newness of life. Have a new conversation. Have a new mind. Have a new spirit. Yeah. Have a new joy. Have a new song. Everything God wants us to have is new. So let's walk in the newness of life. And that's where your holiness and your sanctification continues to be progressive in your life by putting off and putting on.
Absolutely. I was going to say, this is so important for us to get, and I mean, just put a foundation on it. I mean, just make it based. Mm-hmm. Right? Groundwork so that believers can move on. That was the whole point. Who are we and what are we called to do?
Right.
And this
is
so important. I pray that people look at this over and over and over and over and listen and then do some research and get some scriptures for themselves and let the Holy Spirit, who's nurturing, who's directing, who's feeding us, and add on and add on and on so they can get a clearer view of everything, everything we don't say in this Bible study. The Holy Spirit will reveal and open up to them to cause them to be more powerful.
He's the teacher.
He's the teacher. You know, and we got to get this thing because we got too much to do. We have to give glory to our Father. I was going to say make our Father proud and glorify, bring glorification to Him because He's given us so much and we have to make good with it. So we establish that we're to take off the old and put on the new. Mm-hmm. A fruit is holiness. A fruit is sanctification. Let's establish this one. A type of a fruit is also generosity. Now, Pastor Dykeman, Lord have mercy. This is where we get all tripped up.
Yeah.
You know, when it comes to bearing that fruit of generosity, this is where the pocketbook gets tight. Mm-hmm. This is where the hands get clammy and sticky. Mm-hmm. I don't know, you know, if I should give. I know they're asking for this need and that need and how many needs they got. But this is also a part of the fruit of the Spirit, you know. And so it says that there is a fruit that we should bear, and that is generosity. Mm-hmm. Paul established that. I was also thinking of the rich man. He had all that money and stuff like that. And Jesus said, you got to give to the poor. He's like, that's where he cut the corners at. I mean, he had a tough time.
I got to go.
And Ananias and Sapphira. Wanted to keep some of it for themselves, and the Holy Spirit knew of that. But let's look at this one before I get caught off there because I'm looking at my time. Fruit of generosity, the fruit of generosity. Now, Paul talks about this in Acts, the second chapter. Of what type of church, what type of characteristics we should have. It talks about the church that was a joyful church, a church that was a...
Well, that's Luke actually doing the writing at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, not Paul, but Luke. Luke. Acts 2, yes, Luke.
Okay. Thank you. I'm looking at this right here.
Yeah, you're looking Romans at 15. Romans. Yeah, I know you're looking
I'm
at
looking
that.
I'm looking at Romans 15 and 28 with the Apostle Paul.
Yeah.
Talking about the characteristics of the early church. But in Acts, let's go back to that. Then Acts 22. I hadn't gotten there to read that scripture yet, but I will read it. Acts 2... 44 through 45, all the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and good they gave to anyone as he had need. So God has not commanded us to follow their exact example per se in the house and that sort of thing, but he has told us to share with everything that we have according to the need. So giving and being generous is a generosity. Did you want to add on to that?
Yeah, you know, giving is one of those things that I believe really operates out of empathy, right?
Right.
If you're not empathetic towards other people, then you probably won't be much of a giver. If you're not empathetic towards the mission of the church, you probably won't be a pretty big giver.
Right.
Empathy means you put yourself in somebody else's place or somebody else's shoes. And if the church is trying to feed somebody or send somebody on a mission trip or trying to maintain a house of God so people can come pray, so they can be heated in the house and air conditioning and lights on so that the house stays clean or comfortable, whatever. Whatever that church has need of, when you put yourself in that place to say, God, what if I had to take care of this church? What would it take, you know, to run this church? You will start putting yourself in that place and say, you know what? we got to give to this ministry because this ministry is doing the right things in the community, in the earth. It's preaching the gospel, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. You have to have a place of empathy many times. Many times people don't give because they're not empathetic towards the cause or empathetic toward those who are even in need. Mm-hmm. You know, the church take a special collection for somebody in need.
And not having empathy could come from a spirit of fear, just fearful.
It could be almost anything.
Yeah.
But you know, it could be that you never had anybody really care for you. Mm-hmm. You may have come
or
up
give
in a home.
You anything.
Yeah, you may have come from a home where people were just mean and
you had a little bit. You know, that's that bit, fear. You don't want to give a whole lot.
Didn't resolve conflicts with one another. And so it was a dog eat dog kind of situation within the family circle, mm-hmm. and everybody just looked out for themselves.
Right.
So now you're looking out for yourself. Mm-hmm. And so the church may take a collection for somebody that has a need, and then because you're not empathetic, you'll say things like, well, they ain't take no collection for me when I had a need.
That's right.
You know, and you'll see everything through that lens. And before you know it, you won't give. One of the most basic principles of giving will always be empathy, sympathy, and love. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're not in those realms, empathy, sympathy, and love, then giving is not probably going to be one of your go-to things that you do. But people who are very empathetic, people who are sympathetic, you know, they'll give to a lot of things, you know, the March of Dimes, you know. We're not just talking about the church, they'll give to a lot of things. Now, the other thing is this. Generosity should always be, also be, the giving of your time and your talent, your abilities.
Absolutely.
That generosity should always be that as well.
Yeah.
You know, you need to be generous in the fact that God saved you. Mm-hmm. God blessed you. God made you the conduit for these blessings. And out of that, you're grateful. You're happy. You're glad that God gave. And, you know, my father said something I never forget, which I applied to many other things. And even my sister Barbara said something along these lines before. And I said to my dad, how did you raise a family in the 40s, mm-hmm. the 50s,
60s.
The 60s,
yep.
and the 70s.
Money. Yeah.
How did you do that? You had 9 kids. Mm-hmm. How did you raise a family with 9 kids
yeah.
in the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, the 70s? I mean, how'd you do that?
Yeah.
And he said to me, because I believe if God gave me enough food for one,
yep,
he'll give me
said.
Enough food for two.
They did say
if
that.
If he gave me enough food for two, he'll give me enough for three. That's what he said.
Yeah.
And I remember my sister Barbara, she was still living here in Philadelphia, and it was somebody that was in need. And she was going in her cabinet, pulling stuff out and, you know, putting it in a bag so she could give to the family or the need that she was giving to. And I said, girl, you gonna mess around? You gonna empty out all your cabinets? She said, God will fill them back up.
That's where their faith was. We grew up learning
she
that,
said,
understanding
God will fill them
that.
Back up. You
we
know what I mean?
We grew up with giving hands and loose pockets and things like that.
Yeah,
Pastor Dykeman.
You know.
Yeah.
What you gonna do with that?
Yeah.
What you gonna
now,
do? With
now,
that?
Now the difference is back in those days, also in the 40s, in the 50s, in the 60s, and so on. Mm-hmm. We grew up as a community family. Remember,
right.
We grew up as a village. You
right.
used to could ask your neighbor,
right,
I'm baking
right,
a cake,
right,
I don't
right,
have
right,
no
right,
butter.
Right, right, right,
right,
right, right, right.
I'm baking
right,
a
right.
cake, I don't have any butter.
Right, right,
I need to bake some chicken, I don't have enough salt.
Mm-hmm.
So this was generosity. They was bearing mm-hmm. the fruit of generosity. Mm-hmm. People gave and
they gave what they had.
Mm-hmm. And but I was going to say they gave mm-hmm. liberally.
Right.
They didn't think, well, I'm not going to have enough because you got 8 kids mm-hmm. and I got 9 kids. And, mm-hmm. and if I give you some of mine, I'm not going to have enough. They didn't do that.
Right.
Everybody
right, right.
shared. So, mm-hmm. yeah, their conversation was going to be, if I have enough for one, I have enough for 10. And
right.
then you had some awesome bad women. Anyway, we knew how to, you know, make the meals
yeah,
and stretch
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
it would make
yeah.
those biscuits and the beans, and you could have mm-hmm. the same meal over and over.
Yeah,
it was just so
yeah.
delicious because
yeah.
we were more family-oriented.
Right, right,
We
right.
were more family-oriented. We were more mm-hmm. faith-minded, faith-focused.
Right.
And people shared more. And then mm-hmm. all of a sudden, the times and the generations began
yeah.
to change,
yeah.
and people became
yeah.
more selfish.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, that spirit came into the church, and people became
right, right.
selfish. I mean, I guess it was always in there when we're looking at, you know,
well, the world is always
the early
full.
Church and that sort of thing. But,
I mean, Israel had selfish people.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so you're always going to find selfish people
you're
in the group.
Always gonna find
but
it,
the thing is this, we had a society.
It began to turn.
But we had a society where most people went to church.
Absolutely. And then people, as time changed, we didn't have to fight as much after the Martin Luther King thing. We could vote and we could have better jobs.
And
we could go to the bank and have our own bank accounts. And, you know, we were educated and our parents sacrificed and suffered so the kids can have better. And they went to college and they was able to brag and say, I was the first to go to college and everybody making good money now. And then all of a sudden we get tight.
Right.
With the hands.
Right.
Instead of continuing that beautiful, beautiful thing, we begin to get tight. My salt is in my house. My butter is in my refrigerator until we are right now. And now that same spirit has crept right into the church when the scripture tells us, as I said, I moved down to another fruit. But in Romans, let me look back. Where was that verse at? Romans something. Romans 15 and, and 28 is where the Apostle Paul was talking about. And so now we've gotten tight. Mm-hmm. And now when there's a need, not only within other people's lives, a need in the church itself. Now, this is a need in God's house.
Right.
And sometimes, man, it's like you don't even want to ask sometimes. Like, oh, my God, we need this. But do we ask? Because people are going to be like, well, what's the need now?
Right.
They asked last week. But that's all you got to ask. Who you can ask is the church.
Right.
It's just like in your community, when people ran low, that's all they had to ask was their neighbor, and it was never a problem.
Right.
So the Apostle Paul says, we need to, Luke in the second chapter, let me make sure I get that right, because I'm not talking about Paul now, y'all, in the 15th chapter, but Luke and Acts the second chapter, that we need to give and make sure that there was a community, everybody ate. And so we do have to return back like the Church of Acts so that we can make sure that the people have, and not only that, the household of faith have, God's house has what it needs. Let's look at this last fruit because we're running out of time. We're going to pick back up on next week, right on the next verse. On next week, and I'm going to post it so you guys can read along and be prepared for next week. We're going to go to verse 9 and keep going. But the last fruit that we want to talk about.
We got to hit 7 and 8 too.
We're going to hit that. We're going to hit that. Definitely. Did I say we're not?
Yeah, you're
7 and 8?
Okay.
What did I say?
Go ahead.
Tell me what I said so we can make sure the viewers got it right.
No, well, you said we'll go to verse 9 last week, but I'm saying before the day is over, we got to finish this 7 and 8.
Okay. The last fruit we want to look at is praise and worship. That's a powerful fruit because a lot of times people don't think that praise and worship is a fruit, but it is. It is. Here, the author of Hebrew exhorts us from Hebrew the 13th chapter, verse 15. It says, through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise. The fruit of our lips brings him praise. When we confess the name of Jesus Christ, when we're worshiping, this brings him a praise. You wanted to bring something out in 7 and 8. Let's do that because we're running out of time. I can finish this another time. Let's finish that because we're running out of time.
I think because what you said in the beginning, reading in 7 and 8, you know, it says if you abide in me.
Oh, back in verse 7 and 8?
Verse 7 and 8,
okay.
Yeah. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples.
Okay.
Herein what? Herein this prayer life. If ye abide in me, notice he's been talking about abide. Live in me, married to me, take residence in me, lock up with me, stay with me, don't go a day without me, lean on me, depend on me. If ye abide in me, then he says, my word. The very word, like we said before, that created the heavens and the earth.
Yeah.
The very word who is Jesus. Jesus is the word incarnate. The very word that's spoken, the written word, the spirit of the word.
Right.
He said, if you take that word, my word, remember what Jesus said unto them, the words that I speak are spirit and they are life.
Yeah.
And he says, if you abide in me and then my words abide in you, which means now not only are you married and connected and take residence in him, but you've allowed his word to nurture you and take residence up in you, married to your soul.
Yeah.
You abiding in the word. You abiding in him, and his word is abiding in you. Mm-hmm. There's a seamless connection that goes on. In fact, when you look at a branch on a tree, mm-hmm. it just grows out of it.
Yeah.
It's like a seamless connection.
Right.
It just grows out of it. It just yes. grows out of it. He said, I need that seamless connection coming from me. If ye abide in me, my words abide in you, which means your conscious mind is changing now. Your conscious mind is more thinking his thoughts.
Yes.
Your conscious mind and your behavior are more going towards his ways,
mm-hmm.
which means now you meditate different.
Right.
You
right,
think
right,
different.
Right,
your
right,
mind
right.
is being renewed.
Yeah.
You're capturing kingdom consciousness and kingdom principles on a daily basis.
Yeah.
You're focusing in on eternal things. Your mind is changed. And so as your mind is changed, ye abide in me, my word abide in you. He said, ye shall ask what you will.
Yes.
See, this is powerful now, because now we're talking about the authority that you have in the earth as a believer. We're talking about the authority, the power that you have to ask God whatever you will with a renewed and changed mind that's
yes.
under the government of his mind.
That's right.
That's what he's saying.
That's
as long as
saying.
Your mind is under the government of my mind, and I'm affecting your thought processes, and I'm affecting your ways and your behavior, you abiding in me, my word is abiding in you, you can ask what you will. Listen, and here's the promise, and it shall be done unto you. This is the confidence we have, that if we ask anything according to his will, our mind is connected to his will.
Absolutely.
Our spirit is connected to his will. He hears us.
Yeah.
And as we are abiding in him, and his word is abiding in us, we can ask what we will, and it shall be done unto you herein, within this intimate relationship, herein, in this relationship of prayer and worship, excuse me, and studying the word, herein, in this relationship, is my Father glorified.
Absolutely.
You see, the Father's not going to be glorified by you just trying to produce fruit outside of him. Because he said, without me, you can do nothing.
Yes. Let me go back to that script. Go ahead.
But if you are in that vine, and that word is in you.
Yes.
That wonderful word of God, that wonderful word. Remember, God is love. And so the word of love has got to be in you. God is eternal. So the word in you has got to be eternal. God is righteous. So the word in you has got to be righteous. Just start thinking about the attributes of God, whatever those are, because his word is omnipotent. God's power, the power of God's word, God can do anything. That's why Jesus said, with man, those things are impossible. With God, nothing is impossible.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? He had that word inside of him. When you've got the word in you, that word of you will do some powerful things in the earth that will shock you. That will shock you. And I'm not talking about this name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. I ain't talking about that dumb stuff. I'm talking about when you really are abiding in him, that eternal word is in you.
Yeah.
God is saying things to you that will change the course of people's lives in a heartbeat, will change the course of your life. When you're praying, the Holy Spirit is in there with you as you abide in the vine, and he's giving interpretations that cannot be uttered. He's dealing with groanings that cannot be uttered. He's talking through you. He's ushering things to you. Why? Because you're abiding in the vine.
Absolutely.
That's why you can ask what you will. And herein, in this relationship of prayer and worship in the word, prayer and worship in the word, prayer and worship in the word, here in this relationship is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit.
Much fruit.
Now that's where, you know, you ought to be shouting right now. You ought to be playing your own organ,
yes.
right? Because in that relationship of prayer, worship, and the word, you're praying and you're asking what you will. God is going to make it happen because he's going to be glorified in that relationship, and you'll bear fruit. Listen, in your prayer life.
Absolutely.
Who have you been praying for? What have you been praying for? I mean, what do you have on that altar you really want to see the manifestation thereof?
Yes.
Did you want to see in your lifetime while you're in the land of the living?
Yeah.
I mean, just remember, if I abide in him and his word abide in me, I can ask what I will, and it shall be done. Because in that thing, God is glorified.
I'm going to hop in on that last piece before we go on the part about his word abiding in us.
Right, right.
Because sometimes people hear that. I've talked to many people. People hear that and they're fearful. Like, I don't know, like, what to ask God. I have this privilege. I have this liberty. I can ask him anything I want. But the scripture says here in verse 7, I'm glad we went to verse 7 and 8. Mm-hmm. It says, if his word abides in you. Mm-hmm. Now, here's the beautiful mm-hmm. thing about this release and this liberty and this authority that God has given us to ask him anything. He has so said it mm-hmm. that if we know the word of God, if we're studying the word of God, if we know the heart of God, when we ask anything of him, we're not going to ask anything outside of his will.
Exactly right.
We're going to ask it according to his word. So listen, mm-hmm. God mm-hmm. is entrusting us mm-hmm. with the heaviness of this word. We're not going to ask mm-hmm. him something asinine. We're not going to ask him nothing crazy. Mm-hmm. We're not going to ask him anything that's out of the mm-hmm. will of God. Mm-hmm. We're going to mm-hmm. ask according to his word.
Yeah, because you got to remember, it's the Holy Spirit that's shaping
our
mind.
That's a whole lot of trust from,
it's the Holy
trust
Spirit.
From our daddy.
Well, he's trusting
you.
Because he put his spirit in us.
Yes.
You know, he can't trust us to ourselves.
He can't.
He has to put his spirit in us.
And our responsibility as believers,
glory
then,
to God.
Our responsibility is to be able to fulfill the richness of verse 7 is to know the word of God. That's one of the reasons why the Holy Spirit mandated me to do the walk through the word.
Right.
He said, if you can just see, because people can hear the preaching of the gospel. I mean, we share the word of God richly.
Right.
Right. We love a good word. I love a good preacher. We all love a good preacher.
Right.
But the thing is, we hear the good preach, Pastor Dykeman, mm-hmm. and a lot of times we walk away with a lack of understanding, doing the same thing over mm-hmm. and over. So God said to me, if my people can just get the word, if we can just read the word. This is so important for us to be established and understand, mm-hmm. have a knowledge and an understanding and a work and power from the word of God. And when we get that, mm-hmm. we can ask what we will. Because we're not going to ask anything contrary or mm-hmm. outside of the will or the word of God. This then makes our Father happy.
Well, it's like the psalmist said, delight thyself in the Lord.
Yes.
And he will
give you the
desires of
your heart. That's the key right there.
Because
I don't want anybody
heart.
To move away saying, but what we but, have this authority. What do we ask?
But you have to delight yourself in him.
You have to ask according to his word. It says it right there.
But you have to delight yourself in him.
Yeah.
In other words, that's a prerequisite
to
getting whatever you will.
Yes.
If you have to delight yourself in him.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
I would that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers.
Yeah.
Your
you
soul
gotta
prospers.
Know the, we got to know
is,
the word.
It's the prerequisite.
We got to know the word of
and
God.
So it's,
we
it,
have to
so
know
So it's a
word.
Matter of getting the word, whether it's preached or taught, or you just sit there and read, and then making application of the word. You see?
You know, and we have to get this word so much so with all that you're saying, we are so much of an agreement mm-hmm, with mm-hmm, this teaching mm-hmm. and what we share. Because the one thing I know about us, and I can speak about that when I say mm-hmm. us, is we're black people. Black, we're emotional. Right, mm-hmm. we like to move and we mm-hmm. like a groove and you know we got that African move and music mm-hmm. and we just mm-hmm. got that thing. I don't know what to call mm-hmm. it other than we just like that mm-hmm. you know that emotion and that drive. And sometimes it just buckle down in that word is the hardest thing. It's almost like the same way when it's time for people to buckle down to prayer. I'm just bored. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know what it's not moving you enough. So therefore, mm-hmm. there's not a lot of people who are established well with giving God his word back, because it mm-hmm. takes time, man. We got to mm-hmm. buckle down. Yeah. We have to become disciplined. Mm-hmm. We have to literally set a time. And mm-hmm. then we have to focus our mind to say, instead mm-hmm. of saying, oh, you know, I got to take some time. My favorite show is on, or my girlfriend want me, or
right
my
now, they
guy
have no favorite show long.
You know what
home.
I mean? You know, you just want all this wasted time. We have to be disciplined to know that if we're going to be fruitful, if we're going to glorify the Father, we have to abide in this word. We got to take some time and study this word of God. And not only that, I'm telling you, listen, we can speak to the enemy over any circumstances that may not be related to what we're talking about, but I'm telling you, there's a power in that thing.
Well, I think the question
there's
would
a
be
power
that,
in that thing.
But I think the question would be, well, what does that really mean for his word to abide in us?
Okay.
And that's the question that got to answer, because some people may think that that just means repeating what they heard. That's a part of it.
Right.
Because the only way you're going to learn something is through repetition.
Right.
I don't care who you are.
That's just a part of it.
That's just a part of it. But it, you know, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. The Bible says, goes on to say, because they reject truth.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that they didn't get the knowledge or don't have the knowledge. They reject the application of the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And when you reject the application,
I feel what you're saying. Yeah.
Let's say, you know, somebody preached or taught or read something and they got understanding and then they decided, I ain't doing that.
Right, right, right.
You know, well, you could do that. You could do that if you want to, but you won't get the benefit of the power of the word of God in your life. You know, but, you know, people say, well, I don't know if I would do that, Pastor. I mean, if I understand it, I guess I would apply it. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I understood tithes when they taught it the first time.
Yeah, I was going to say, they don't always abide in that word and do what it says. They do what they want.
I didn't give up tithes right away. I didn't do that.
Especially when you got to take it off the net.
And the thing is, I was a giver.
No, it's not mind giving. It's the gross, right? Not the net. It's the gross. Gross we pay.
It's the gross. But I didn't mind giving. But I'm like, how you gonna put a 10% thing on me every time you see me? You know, that was my whole mindset. Now,
a lot of people's mindset
and so
still there.
Your mind is caught up in things from the world or the way you did things in the world, and you're not really thinking kingdom. You're not thinking about the multiplication that comes out of the kingdom.
Right.
Because the multiplication that comes out of the kingdom is exponential. I mean, it's mind-boggling.
Right.
You know, but you're not really thinking about that right now. You're holding on to the 10, you know. And you got your fist clenched, and God can't put 1,000 in there. He can't put 10,000 in there because you're just holding on to the little 10%.
Mm-hmm.
And God is teaching us, listen, let me give it to me.
Yep, that's what he says.
And let me do what I need to do in the earth. And I may not send you a check, but watch your kids go to college for free.
The favor.
Let me. I'll bring favor into your life.
To
I will
favor.
Do stuff in you.
Man,
you will never forget.
You got that right.
There may not be a new car hanging outside because you gave your tithe.
Right.
But if your kids go to college for free,
mm-hmm.
come on now. I mean, all kinds of things that God will do in your life that will bless you when you really learn how to give into kingdom principles. So it's like you can learn the word, but will you apply the word?
That's it.
And I don't want to just harp on tithes and offerings and get into a whole drawn out thing. It's just an example.
Well, you know, that went into the fruit of generosity. We talked about that a little bit from the fruit of generosity.
Right, right. But I didn't want to get into that. But the thing is, if God says man should always pray and not faint, and you don't pray.
Right.
I know I should pray. I just don't feel like praying. Well, you just made a decision, not to apply the word.
Mm-hmm.
You just made that decision. You got the knowledge, but you rejected it because you wanted to see the reruns of Gunsmoke.
Yeah.
See? You know what I'm saying? You wanted to see.
See?
You know,
that's what I'm saying.
You know, you wanted to see your favorite show or whatever. You should
that's
have one
right.
by now. But
that's right.
You wanted to see something in particular.
Yeah.
You know, something that you could probably, what they call that thing, Trevo, Tebow, or something. You can watch it later if you want to, or something.
Oh, I don't know.
They got all this stuff on these TVs now. You ain't gotta watch the program when the program is on. You hit a little button, you can watch it later. It's all kind of stuff. You got all these kind of convenience, but then we gotta act like, no, I gotta see it when it first comes on.
Because
I don't want nobody on social media talking about it.
Get
off social media then.
Thank you.
You know, whatever you gotta do. You know, get away from something.
To get the word
to get
in
the
you.
Word.
So you can abide in the word.
And
that's
so,
right.
And so when you're abiding in the word, it means not only are you reading it.
Yes.
And remembering it, you know, putting it to memory.
That's right.
But now you're studying it.
Yeah.
I mean, why did Paul say that? Why did Peter say that? Why did John say that? Why did Jesus say that? What was going on in that time? What are the hermeneutics around it? What was happening in the culture?
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean the same thing for us today? You know, their thing may have been a cultural thing, but does that mean there's a principle there within that cultural thing?
Mm-hmm.
How do we apply that same eternal principle without being in that culture?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we want to pull out. We always want to pull out the eternal principle.
Mm-hmm.
We always want to pull out the eternal principle.
Right.
We always want to pull out the eternal principle, right?
Right.
You know, like when he says, wives keep silent in church.
Right.
Well, the women were up in the balcony, the men were down on the floor. Ain't no yelling back and forth. We're going to teach the men go home and ask questions. You go and you teach yourself at home. Well, we don't have that situation anymore.
Right.
But all he was talking about was the eternal principle was order.
Right.
That's all that was about. That was about order. So how do we keep order in the house of God? That's what he's talking about. How do we keep the house of God from being a confused place? And that means in so many ways. That'll mean just preaching from the pulpit. That means in so many different ways. He was just talking about order. How do we keep things in order? That's right. The eternal principle. How do I keep things in order in my house? How do I keep things in order on my job? How do I keep things order in my personal life when nobody else is around?
That's right.
It's about order. We grab the eternal principle out of it and we apply it to where we are in life. Mm-hmm. If you and I say the word abides in us, that means we're living in that word. We're not just getting it to memory. We studying that word. We want to know what
and
that word means.
And that's what I was about to say.
You know
that
what I
means
mean?
That we have to study that word and become disciplined in that word. And then on a daily basis, walk in the word.
Right. Read some commentators. You know, good brother, Ravi Zacharias from Home to Be with the Lord.
Yeah.
This brother, man, Jesus, man. You know, when you read some of his stuff or you get him on a speech, you can pull him up on YouTube.
Yeah.
And he was an apologist for the body of Christ.
Okay.
I mean, this brother, I mean, just reading his stuff. In other words, read other authors. Mm-hmm. You know,
To enrich and expand your thinking. Yeah.
I like Derek Prince. Derek Prince is, you know, he's of a Pentecostal flavor, but very smart, very sharp in the word.
Warfare and...
Oh, you know, he does, yes. Yeah. Spiritual warfare. So just read other authors, other commentators. What did they say about that passage of scripture? In other words, study that passage. Just study that passage from different schools of thought. Some stuff you're going to agree with, some stuff you're not going to agree with. But study it. Ask the Holy Spirit to be the teacher. Because whoever is in that commentary, they are the instructor.
Right.
They're not the teacher.
Right.
They're the instructor. They're the professor in the college. They're the teacher in your homeroom, I guess. I guess y'all not in the homeroom no more, but you know what I'm saying, right?
Absolutely. We get that point that was made. You have to pull out those eternal principles.
Yeah.
The only way to be able to do that is to have the word of God on the inside. So we'll go back to the original statement, and that is that we must become disciplined.
We have to
turn that television off.
Yeah.
We have to set our mind and move forward with that.
Because
the spirit is constantly fighting and warring against the flesh, and the flesh is constantly warring against the spirit. So when I go into the study of the word, I'm going in thinking that I'm going to be enriched. I'm going in thinking the Holy Spirit is going to open up my understanding. He's going to illuminate thought to me and give me something that I've never seen before. So we can't go in thinking I'm going to be bored and I'm going to be tired. You got to watch it, because a lot of times becoming disciplined and studying the word of God, Pastor Pinnock used to say the sleep demon came on you. As soon as you start reading that word, you go to sleep. And then also, you know, you put your feet up and say, well, I'm just going to get in the bed tonight and put my feet up and study the word of God. No, in about 5 minutes. Couldn't sleep all week. Had insomnia all week. Soon as you get that Bible, you fall straight to sleep. So we have to be, you know, very disciplined. And so this is so important for us to understand what our fruits are. Absolutely. You have to get that word of God down on the inside of you.
I'm trying to figure this thing out on what you call it.
I think we're gonna be good. So I mean, if we begin to sum this session, this study, you know, God has given each one of us really our own ministries to fulfill. And what I mean by that, he's given all of us something so that we can be in the right place doing exactly what he put in us, he established in us to do. And I have a couple of things here, whether it's a dairy truck driver, working in an office, a hospital, whether you're home, you're homeschooling, or you're just a homemaker. Sometimes people look at that as very small and very little, but that's very important. Mm-hmm. You know, that is a ministry, being a homemaker, whether you're in a school or a gardener or your business or whatever it is, all these particular combinations of our gifts and our talents and our abilities and all of these opportunities help us to fulfill the ministry that God has given us. That's how we become fruitful. Mm-hmm. And the unsaved person, I wanted to bring this point out, you know, they may be working in some of these other areas that I talked about, but they're not fruitful. A lot of times they could be working in business or banks and steal. You know, but if you are bringing forth good fruit, you working in a bank or something like that, you're going to work in honesty, in integrity, and having the character of Christ. This is how we're going to bear good fruit for the Lord.
Amen.
Well, it's been awesome. Did you want to say anything last?
No, that's it.
Or more?
That's it.
I should say
it.
Not
we'll come
less,
back
but
next
more.
Week.
before we go
off. Can't tell it all at one time.
You can't tell it all. It was wonderful. Mm-hmm. It's always wonderful. I know that everybody that came in tonight enjoyed the Word of God. This has been a powerful series. Mm-hmm. Abiding in the Vine, Christ mm-hmm. as the true vine. We're going to come back again on next week. And what I was saying, not that we shouldn't have covered 7 and 8, but we're going to come back next week with mm-hmm. verse number 9 mm-hmm. on next week, and we're going to pull that apart. But thank God for all of you. Now, let's see. Do we want to try to go here just for a few minutes? I usually start from the bottom. We thank God for you, Minister Folk. God bless you and pray that you have a wonderful evening. Mother Thomasina, God bless you. Sister Sharon Banton, God bless you. Minister Darlene, amen. God bless you. Minister Burgess, we praise the Lord for Minister Jenkins and Mother Lyles. God bless you. Stoney, hey, how are you? Samir was with us tonight. Mm-hmm. Hi, Samir, how are you? Shamika was with us tonight. Mother Gloria Moore was with us tonight. Corey was with us tonight in Bible study. All of our Bible study lovers, I'm telling you, we're remaining students in the Word of God for life. Jalen with us tonight. Hey, our daughter, God bless you. Let's see. And Leanna was with us tonight. We praise God for you, Leanna. Sister Rochelle, amen. Sister Marcy, Mother Teresa, praise the Lord. Sister Gwen, amen. Stoney had something up here tonight. Wanted to look at that. But we'll address that. We'll address that with you a little bit later on, Stoney. Okay?
Praise God. You got two Stonies there.
We have two Stonies?
Two Stonies.
I only know one.
Yeah, you got Stoney Wendell.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. You know what? That's exactly right. Stoney Wendell Brown. Yes. Amen. Let's see. And she had something about open hearts and arms. Thank you. Thank you, Stoney. Stoney's always edifying and always building. And we just praise God for her life. And she talked about, I like her honesty on here. She made a remark about moving away from the Lord and getting her roots and everything nurtured. So we praise God for that. So I think we got everybody. And if we didn't, we just want to say thank God for you. Amen. For everyone that came on. We're going to come back next week. Now, we're not having Bible study in the morning. Right?
I'm going to try and see.
You're going to try? Okay, we'll see what's going to happen with Bible study in the morning, but we'll make that announcement earlier enough. We thank God for all of your hearts that are coming in on this screen. We thank God for you. Okay, so we're going to go tonight, and we're going to let the rest of, can we have a Jubilee song on the way out? Amen. One of our songs. I'm just loving that CD. As the Lord is just bringing some refreshment to us from our CD. So we're going to just close out in just a tad of that. Make sure that you share this. Make sure that you put some comments in. I always go back, Pastor Dykeman, we always go back and we look at the comments that's in the screen. And I always close out by saying this, that I love you. Pastor Dykeman loves you. A lot of people may love you, but let me tell you about a person who loves you more than anybody. And his name is Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Now listen to that.
Come gather around the throne of God. Come lift up praise and give him glory. Come ye. Come all.
Yes, we share. Thank you, Mother Thomasina.
Teddy Pendergren is a gospel.
Okay. So we're not going to play too much of that tonight to hold you guys on. We're working on it so we can get it up on iTunes. So we want to give you a good head up when we get to that point. Alright? So. Alright. Good night. Just wanted to play just a little bit of that. Good night, everybody. Have a peaceful night. God bless you. Bye-bye.